I'm Joe Chuman. I'm a leader of the Ethical Culture Society, and I'd like to welcome you to our advocacy forum, which will prove to be a very engaging, exciting, and relevant event, especially for the SAGE demographic. That's a joke.
Okay. I laugh.
We're talking about Never Say Die. It's a book that unmasks the mythologies, okay, of being forever young. But before I introduce our guest, let me just extend a very warm welcome to all of you. And to those of you who may be just joining Ethical Culture for the first time or picking us up, we are a humanistic community that is dedicated to upholding the dignity of all human beings, but we pursue our interests in an environment which is not theologically based or grounded. The history of ethical culture is one of social justice, our external history, and many proud accomplishments. The New York Society these days is a very program-rich community, and all of you who have come in have gotten a gift packet, which among other things lists the upcoming programs, and we would encourage you to pick and choose those that interest you and get to know us better, become engaged, and enjoy the spirit of the place, the ideas that we can impart and which we can share. This remains a very, very vital, and I dare say from the point of view of the values we promote, very relevant in today's world. One program that I do want to highlight is our next advocacy forum, which will also be an interview with a noted writer, but I will not be the interviewer. We're having as our guest Jeremy Ben-Ami, who is the founder and president of the J Street Lobby. Many of you who know and follow Middle Eastern politics know that J Street is a liberal answer to the AIPAC lobby. And Ben-Ami has written a book called A New Voice for Israel. He will be here on July 21st. At 7 o'clock, and he'll be interviewed on the book A New Voice for Israel by James Traub, who writes for the New York Times. So we're able to find a very distinguished interviewer to interview a very distinguished writer and public personality, Jeremy Ben-Ami. Again, the date is July 21st at 7 p.m., and the meeting will take place not in this room, but downstairs in the auditorium. So we extend a very warm welcome to you all for the next advocacy forum event. But let's talk about this one. I'm very happy to say that we have as our guest Ms. Susan Jacoby, who is a very prolific writer. Susan is the author of 9 books, among them Freethinkers, A History of American Secularism, and The Age of American Unreason. And I should say that professionally, I've made great use of both of these books. They're really very valuable resources for humanists and those concerned with contemporary issues. Susan has worked as a reporter for the Washington Post and has been a director of the New York branch of the Center for Inquiry. Susan Jacoby has also been a nominee for the Pulitzer Prize. We're interviewing Susan this evening on her latest book, Never Say Die, subtitled The Myth and Marketing of the New Old Age. Please join me in extending a very warm welcome to Susan. This is our format, it's very simple. I will ask questions, I'll talk short, Susan will talk long. I'll ask questions, not too long. The question, my part of the program will extend for about an hour or so, and then we'll open up the floor to questions. And I'd like to cap the program at 9 o'clock. I don't want to go beyond. Okay, so we'll finish at that point. Susan, oh yes, of course, and after that, yes, thank you, obviously, Susan's book is for sale. Let me just tell you, it's a great read. It really is a beautifully written book, very absorbing and engaging. Maybe a little off-putting at some point, a little upsetting, but that's part of the incisiveness and the relevance of Susan's work. Let me ask you, first of all, what was your motivation, Susan, for writing Never Say Die?
I think almost craziness now. No, actually, there are two reasons. Obviously, when I started thinking about this, I was... is this not on?
It is on.
Yeah,
I'm not close enough to it. Okay. All right. Okay. Is that better? Okay. First of all, I was getting into my 60s and obviously thinking more about issues associated with aging. Secondly, my partner of many years died 3 years ago of cancer, but he also had Alzheimer's disease. He was quite a bit older than I am, and so that there was that element of it. And third, a few years ago, I went to a session at the World Science Festival in New York, and it was titled, 90 is the New 50. And I thought to myself, I went to it because I looked at the ads for it, and I thought, who could possibly believe this? And when I went there, first of all, the room was packed. I mean, there were 10 times as many people as there are in this room. And the atmosphere was really like, you know, Sister Sharon's revival meetings in Elmer Gantry. It was mostly people, I would say, in their 40s and 50s. And there were three people on the panel. Two were researchers promising that there were going to be drugs within just a couple of years to cure Alzheimer's. One of these drugs, the drug companies already dropped the research on it because it didn't work out in people like mice. And the other, the voice of sanity, was Dr. Robert Butler, whom some of you may actually know, and he died of leukemia last year. And Bob was the voice of reason on the panel. He was the first director of the National Institute on Aging, and so on. So there were all three motivations. I mean, it seemed to me that a lot of the irrationality I've been writing about in other areas also coalesced around the subject of old age.
It seems to me that the thesis of the book really centers around your concern with how aging and old age is currently depicted in American life. Can you talk about that depiction and why you think it's problematic?
Well, on the one hand, there are a lot more positive images of the old than there were, say, when I was in my 20s in the 1960s. The image of being old that I had when I was, let's say 20, was that, you know, this was an age when you got in your 60s, when your life ended when a man retired and he returned home to bother his wife, and her only role was that of babysitter for her grandchildren. And I think that's how old age was seen pretty much then. That did begin to change in the 60s for a number of reasons, one of them simply being increasing longevity. There were a whole lot more old people over 65 and people over 80 by the late 1960s than there were when my grandmother was born at the turn of the last century.
Unfortunately, I'm having a terrible time.
I'm going to have to move out here because sure. There's a bar that's preventing me from sitting properly. Okay. The second thing is, so I think images of the old today are more positive, but I think they're no less unrealistic because while the image of the old that's presented today is not uniformly negative at all, but one of the things I think that the AARP magazine for which I've written and the AARP itself in emphasizing, putting its emphasis now on people in their 50s, you know, anytime they write the secrets of 10 wonderful old people, one of them is 80, the rest of them are all under 65. So I think that old, in that respect, has come to be defined as the young old, people in their 60s and 70s. And people who are living now in increasing numbers, and will even more in my generation, into their 80s and 90s, what life is like for them is pretty much skipped over. It's great to be old, as long as you don't exhibit any of the typical problems of the old in our society. I think the image of the, yeah, we'd all like to be Betty White. We'd all like to be Justice John Paul Stevens, who's writing essays since he retired from the Supreme Court that we'd all love to be able to write at any age. The fact is, 50% of people who live over 85 have dementia, which Alzheimer's is the leading form. And you can't just say, the AARP has been propagandizing for years. I even wrote these articles, some of them. And that's another reason I wrote this book. that Alzheimer's is not an age-related disease. This is utter nonsense. Anything that affects half of all people in one age group is certainly an age-related disease. The risk of Alzheimer's doubles in every five-year period over 65. Again, not that we all don't want to be in the dementia-free half, but you can't look at old age without looking at this broad picture. It would be very nice if we were all sexy skydiving centenarians. Then there would be no Social Security or Medicare problem because we'd all be well until we dropped dead of that proverbial heart attack that the baby boom generation dreams of, never having been sick a day in our lives, preferably while making love or paragliding or something like that. Then we don't have to think about how to pay for old age.
Well, okay, please see if I understand the problem here. The problem here is that society in general and certain interests in society, when they talk about old age, are focusing on what we might call the young old, let's say those between 65 and 85, but are blind to the existence and the realities of the old old, that is, 85 and beyond. Is that primarily what you're concerned
with? Yeah, and I think also the media focus on the best case scenarios too, again, which we'd all like, but we wouldn't, you know, a good example of this is all talk now about raising the retirement age for future generations, for Social Security, raising the eligibility age for Medicare. Now, I'm not a fan of retirement, and if I'm lucky enough to have my wits about me until I die, I intend to go on writing until the reading public retires me, which certainly could always happen. However, that's not to say, raising the retirement age to 70, it sounds so reasonable. That's great for people who haven't done physical labor their whole lives. But what about, and I'm not talking just about coal miners and people who've worked in the subways underground and so on. What about people who've made their whole living standing down on their feet behind retail counters? Is it so easy for them? I go to the Allen Room, which is a special place for nonfiction writers at the New York Public Library. It has really wonderful ergonomically designed chairs. It's a great place to work. But what about the women I see behind the counters in the grocery store on my way home? My own age, which is 65, mostly black and Hispanic, standing on their feet all day. They don't have a nice ergonomically designed chair to work in all day. What does that mean for them to raise the retirement age to 70? And so I think when I talk about this too rosy image of the new old age, part of that is also a very class-bound image. The Today Show on the first Monday of this January, 2011, kicked off the story of the oldest baby boomers turning 65 this year. What was the segment title? It was titled Forever Young. I deliberately use the word old in my book because old is a dirty word, and the correspondents didn't use the word old once. What did they use? There are two euphemisms for old in our society. One is aging, which is particularly stupid. My nieces are in their 20s and they're aging, but they're certainly not old. And the other is older. Well, older than whom? Older. This is a real problem when we talk about things solely from an upper middle class standpoint, which, need I say, that everyone who works on television is an upper middle class person. And who are they? They're people who have had access to excellent health care through the ones who are left or still have jobs. They're people who, for the most part, are thin. They are people who have lived life the way that things like realage.com and Dr. Oz tell you to live it. That is not the way most of America lives or has the money to live. So that we're not looking realistically about how to provide for an aging population if we're only looking at the well-off or the weller-off, I guess, to paraphrase the older thing.
Right. Well, this gets me to segues into my next question. Clearly, you're trying to unmask a mythology. You're pointing to a social falsehood. But the question I would like you to elaborate on, Susan, is why is this necessarily harmful? And you began to get into that, so I'm wondering if you can do that.
why is it necessarily harmful?
Right.
Well, first of all, if we really convince ourselves that 90 is the new 50, then there's no need to have a serious discussion about how to make 90 a better 90 and 80 a better 80 and 70 a better 70. If you really buy into this idea that everybody older is just, you know, healthy and happy as larks and there's no problem. Oh, and also has the money to live on a 30-year retirement. That too, you can talk about cutting Medicare and Social Security benefits if you think everybody has money. And that's another myth, and I'm not fully answering your question yet. One of the greatest myths in American society is that everybody, if only they behave well, has the capacity to save enough money to live well into their 90s. This is just nonsense. The median income for a family of four in the United States today is about $53,000 a year. Now, you think about that. Think about it. All right, New York is one of the most expensive areas of the country, but most Americans don't live in towns like Oklahoma, Mississippi, and Boise, Idaho. If you are 40 years old, let's say, in your mid-40s, you have this family income of $50,000 plus a year, which again is the median. You've got two kids who are entering college age. Now, do we really want a society in which these 50-something parents say to their kids, sorry, honey, can't help you with school. I've got to save for my long-term care. I don't think that's, you know, the idea that it's almost a kind of moral turpitude if you haven't managed to save enough for as long an old age as many people who are now in their mid-60s are going to have. This is just wrong. So that I think it's the economic parallel of the idea that if only we take really good care of ourselves, none of these bad things will happen to them. If we exercise enough, eat enough green vegetables, keep our minds active enough, then that this is somehow a protector against all of the diseases of old age. So the harm is if you assume these things to be true, that everything is within our control, and if we just behave like good middle-aged and young old men and women, well, there's nothing to fear if we live to be 90 years old. Then we don't come to grips with the reality.
Yep. I want to get back, though, to the division, and here I just want to play the devil's advocate for a moment. The division between the young old, 65 to 85, and the old old. You talked about questions of class, which are clearly very important, and you know, feel free to fold that analysis into your response. But isn't it true, couldn't we argue that in great measure, because of the initiatives in society that have promoted a youthful old age, that there in fact have been positive gains for the young old, not the old old? But when I look at my parents' generation, and you sort of started off implying this, didn't you, that there really have been, people who are young old are now more vigorous, okay, and are living more active lives than they did 40, 50 years ago. Is that correct, at least for segment?
I don't know. I actually don't know if that's true, and I don't think really anybody does. I know we all like to think that. Before I finished this book, I looked at some pictures of my parents when they were in their 60s. You know what? They looked great. They were wearing shorts. They weren't particularly rich, but they looked like everything that we're supposed to think that only our generation looks like. Almost everybody I know thinks that they are far more youthful than their parents were at the same age. I don't know their parents. We do know that one of the things we have access to is there are a lot of things like high blood pressure and diabetes and all kinds of things for which there are now standard treatments, so that if you do have diseases, they hardly seem like diseases anymore. The fact is, when my dad was 60 years old, there was no high blood pressure medication. You know, just as FDR probably wouldn't have died the way he did if there had been, you know, the kind of instruments we have. But apart from certain advances in medical care and common diseases which are not fail very, very soon, I'm not really sure. For one thing, I think back particularly my grandmother. Another reason I wrote this book, by the way, is I come from a family of women who live into their 90s. I think back, my grandmother was born in 1899, and she died in a nursing home, but with her mind sound, but her body had just failed her. Well, one thing is, of course, many fewer people of my grandmother's generation lived to be the age she was. But in some ways, certainly a lot of scientists think this, they were probably hardier genetic specimens simply because the first parts of their life they survived without antibiotics, without vaccinations. I mean, a lot of us have been aided, whatever genetic endowment we were born with, by medical advances that became routine in mid-century. So I don't really know whether it's true that the young old. I wouldn't say no. But I knew a lot of people when I was in. It's exactly something that people who were anti-Semites but had Jewish friends, or who were racist but had black friends, used to say. Well, of course, so and so is really great, and so you could have. I think what was characteristic of my generation and youth is we could have general prejudice against the old while eliminating many of the vigorous old people we actually knew at the time. I mean, when Dr. Spock was marching in Central Park against the Vietnam War, he was born in 1904. There were a lot of those people around then.
That's true. But I must admit, speaking personally, my parents were not among them. They seemed old when they were in their 40s. So my experience is...
Well, I also, you just said to mention class. I also think that's a matter of class. A lot of people who are now in their 60s and 70s had immigrant parents who actually lived much harder lives than
yes,
we have. People who, more of our parents worked hard physically than we have in general. But this is true of the upper middle class, not necessarily people down the economic scale.
One of the aspects of your scholarship around this issue is you put the question of the idealization of youth and the marginalization of age in a historical context. And you go back to the 18th century, to the founding of the Republic. Can you talk a little bit about the history of that? Because it runs against common assumption.
Well, guess what? First of all, we never did a very good job of taking care of the old, even when there were very few of them. Now, this was news to me. When I was doing the historical chapter, I found out that there had been a number of very good books based on New England town records about what old age was like in the colonial era and in the early American Republic, the first 40 years of the 19th century. And one of the things, it was a problem which didn't affect every family because so many people did die by the time they were 40 years old. Half of the population at the time the Constitution was signed was under 16 because so many women died in childbirth and so many people died of infectious diseases that even by the late 19th century didn't carry off. But even so, the old were considered a problem. The first old age pensions, which only went to Revolutionary War veterans, were decreed by President George Washington because these pathetic letters kept coming in from New England, and you can find a lot of them in New England town halls today, about what happened with the old if they didn't have a family, and many of them didn't because Americans were beginning to move west. So sometimes what families did is they moved west and they left the dependent old behind. And what those people would do is they would work for farmers in the area where they lived, and they would be paid with a night in the barn and a meal. That would be their pay. In other words, they basically, you worked till you dropped. And this was true until the late 19th century. The whole idea of pensions and retirements doesn't even begin to come into play for the rich until the 1870s, the 1880s. But so even in the colonial era, when there were so very few old people alive, it was not at all inevitable that, that old people would be taken care of by their families. A few weeks ago, I spoke at a conference on the 75th anniversary of the signing of the Social Security Bill at Tufts University, And a 20-year-old who was working his way through college stood up and asked me what I thought was a very good question, which nobody in either party in Washington is addressing now. And he said, if Social Security isn't going to be there for me, why should I willingly pay to support you? And what would you say to somebody like me? And he said, couldn't this just all be solved by people doing what they used to do, which is taking care of the old in families? Well, first thing is, if the old had been taken care of, there would have been no need for Social Security. In this halcyon past, in 1935, and it wasn't just the Depression, Social Security was not passed. It was possible because Roosevelt had that latitude at that point. But old people were poor. They were very poor. And again, at a time when average life expectancy was 61. So where were those families who were supposedly taking such great care of the elderly? Social Security was passed because the old, as a group, were an impoverished class of people. Mm-hmm. So I said that to him, and I think we do have to be careful about mythologizing this past in which there's, like so much of the American past, there was a time when we had better values and we were a better people. No, I mean, I call Social Security having better values.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can't pass up the opportunity just to cite this. Our founder, Dr. Adler, is looking over your shoulder.
Yes.
And I was happy to see that you actually do mention Felix Adler in your book, both in a positive and somewhat critical vein. As I recall, you mentioned Dr. Adler as being one of the few figures, notable figures of his time, who actually valorized old age.
Yes.
He was positive about it, yet at the same time, he romanticized it in a way in which he didn't have his feet on the ground. And I was wondering, is there anything more you can say about that?
Well, there is. I mean, he wrote a lot about old age, and it's true. In his time, Adler was not a social Darwinist, but a lot of the most educated people of his day were. And their basic attitude was, as those who were fit to survive will survive. That's what Herbert Spencer, who was the guru of his time, said. And a lot of the biggest industrialists in America, what they did was they made the mistake of translating survival of the fittest and competition, natural selection in a state of nature, into something that was also true of man in a state of civilization. Something that Charles Darwin specifically warned against in his writing. He said, once man enters a state of civilization, this idea that things are determined by adaptation and the survival of the fittest, it's no longer true. Our natural human sympathy prevents it from being true. Well, Felix Adler was one of the few sort of prominent men of his generation to really reject the social Darwinist idea. And at the same time, but he also wrote, he of course was somebody who did not lose his mind with old age. And he wrote about old age as a series of wonderful, higher and ever higher plateaus. And I think what I said in the book was, you know, he never dealt with the possibility that it could also, for some, be a series of lower and lower descent. And by the way, Alzheimer's, I'm amazed at the bad scholarship. There are so many books that talk about Alzheimer's as if it were a new problem, a new diagnosis invented by society. Actually, the diagnosis is now over 100 years old. But when you read the letters of old Americans to one another from the 19th century, you understand that this was well known even in those days when so few people survived. John Adams and Thomas Jefferson's letters, great letters written to each other when they were in their 70s, are filled with references to friends who no longer had powers of comprehension, and talking about their physical ailments, but their gratitude that their minds were intact. This is a disease that has clearly been with the human species as long as we've been in this form.
Susan, as I read your book, it seems as if the primary audience that you're addressing, and I think you're addressing several audiences, are baby boomers, and you are actually in the lead. You're 65 now, so you're the first baby boomer, and you're sort of looking back at your cohort here. And I was wondering if you could elaborate for us those factors in the socialization of the baby boomer generation that you think leave them most vulnerable to adopting this false image of the glory of old age.
Well, first of all, we don't believe we're ever going to get old. I think some of us are beginning to realize this now. But
as I like to say, I'm in the twilight of my youth.
But I think more importantly is that we've been raised on ideas of the power of self-transformation through both positive behavior and positive thinking. Now, I should admit here, I'm of a group, some of you may know Barbara Ehrenreich's writing about positive thinking, and I'm pretty much, we're a member of a group of writers called the Negateers, which I think speaks for itself. But I think that the idea that you can make everything right just by behaving well, and that you can always, that your own behavior and the way you think has this not just enormous, I'm not saying that good behavior, quote, good behavior, doesn't have a good effect on your body. Obviously, not smoking, not being a drunk, not eating ding-dongs and tasty cream donuts for three meals a day. Obviously, exercising, all these things are good, but they're good in themselves, not because there's some kind of a magic shield to protect you from getting old. And I think the idea that we are sort of the masters of our fate, the captain of our souls, and responsible for everything that happens to us, and this is particularly found its highest or lowest expression in research designed to blame cancer patients for their own cancer for having bad attitudes. Oh, as if there were a lot of people who fought hard and had a very positive attitude and still died of cancer. And in fact, now research on breast cancer, the largest study in the world in Australia, has shown that. And I don't think too much of this study either. In that, when people describe their attitudes, I don't have much faith in any descriptive studies when people describe their attitudes, but they show that people who self-describe their attitudes as "I'm going to fight" and were described by their relatives that way, the survival rate of the people who took a depressive attitude and the people who took a positive attitude was the same. And I think this idea that your attitude is to blame for things, the same kind of writing appears in some of the literature of Alzheimer's too, saying that, well, really, one of the main things about Alzheimer's is it's not the problem with the patient. The problem is with the caregiver who is upset by the patient's behavior. Now, I wouldn't for a minute deny that caregivers are upset by somebody they love having Alzheimer's. But again, there's this idea that if only you could find the magic way to give the right care, then you could stop this horrible thing happening to somebody you love. The idea is all that everything is within our control, and there's nothing of which this is less true than growing old.
Well, you know, I mean, there's no part in your book where my blood was boiling at a more level. And in that type of description, I remember, just to sort of develop that thought, I remember Bernie Siegel, who was sort of a cancer guru who basically
said the capacity to survive.
And, you know, it seemed to me to be a cruel, for lack of a better word, a cruel way to blame the victim. And look at the people who are giving of themselves in terms of their parents who have Alzheimer's, and to blame them for their parents' condition just seems to me to be such a repugnant idea.
Well, also, and this somehow relates to your earlier question of the harm of not facing up to what the reality is what does our society say to the families of Alzheimer's patients? It says to them, you're on your own. There is no reimbursement through Medicare for some things that are desperately needed, one of them being places of respite for caregivers, where somebody who is still being cared for at home in the intermediate stages of Alzheimer's, where they can be taken for a few hours, because what happens is people in the intermediate stages of Alzheimer's can still enjoy many things. What they cannot do is be left alone. Well, this is a very difficult thing for the caregiver, especially since many caregivers themselves have to work and are the support of their families as well. And to say you're on your own to people, this is one of the consequences of a too rosy vision.
Mm-hmm. Right. There's one phrase that you employ that I want to quote because I really loved it. Rationalist that you are and negateer that you may be, nevertheless, this quote caught my attention, and I'd like you to elaborate on it a little bit because I liked it so much. You say that denial is not necessarily a bad thing as long as we never lose sight of the reality of that which is being denied.
That is a good sentence. I like that.
What I liked about it, Susan, is that you sort of blinked a little bit. I mean, you're willing to concede that maybe in some instances a little bit of denial is not such a bad thing.
Of course, you can't get up every day, look in the mirror, and say, "Hi there, you're going to die soon." you can't get up. There is, I think, a whole cult, but I do think this also relates to the over-control. There is a whole cult of people who are not particularly ill among the young old, but who do absolutely everything that is recommended. They have every screening test that you could possibly have for every disease you could possibly have all the time. And I think this audience is mature enough to know that even if you're feeling great, every time you go to the doctor, they come up with something new that's wrong with you or might be wrong with you. I think there is a line between taking reasonable good care of yourself, you know, getting certain screening tests, but not necessarily everything that every doctor who's afraid of being sued recommends to you, because what if you got that disease and you didn't? I think that there are a lot of people who are really over-concerned with their health in this respect. I have a friend, for instance, who has borderline high blood pressure. I mean, really borderline, more, you know, fairly low. She's taking a very small dose of medication, and she checks her blood pressure about 8 times a day. Her doctor told her this was ridiculous, the medication. But the fact is, and she gets upset every time that she has a day when she has a little bit higher blood pressure than normal. I do think there is a balance between taking sensible care of yourself and being obsessed with the idea, again, that if you just do everything right, nothing bad is going to happen to you. You can have a clean bill of health one day from a doctor and drop dead of a heart attack the next day. Everybody knows that.
Right. I thought the most devastating fact that you cite in your book is that if we look at people over the age of 85, fully 50% of them are stricken with Alzheimer's.
Yeah.
And that statistic is correct.
50% have dementia, which Alzheimer's is responsible for about 90%.
Right. Including early stages.
That's
a very large.
Yeah, it is, which is why to say that it's not an age-related disease is ridiculous. At this panel, Title 90 is the new 50, Bob Butler said something which was very memorable to me. He said this to me in an interview afterwards. I followed up with him. He said, "I'm a scientist and nobody, you know, I would just..."